Hello, and welcome to the 7th Annual Virtual World's Best Practices in Education Conference. My name is Kevin Feenan. I'm also known as Phelan Cormel inside Second Life. And it is my honor today to introduce our 2004 opening keynote speaker, Philip Rosedale. Philip's career has spanned several decades of bringing innovative ideas to market. In 1995, Philip created Freeview, an internet video conferencing product, which was later acquired by Real Networks, and where he went on to become vice president and CTO. In 1999, Philip left Real Networks and to come found Linen Lab and Second Life. Since leaving Second Life in 2010, Philip has worked on several experiments in distributed work and computing. These have included Coffee and Power and Worklist.net. In 2013, he co-founded High Fidelity to explore the future of next-generation virtual reality systems. And now, without any further ado, I would like to introduce Philip Rosedale and his keynote, Closing the Gap, Virtual Reality in Education.
Thanks very much, everyone. I'm feeling I'm trying to walk over here, and I'm running into the edge of the simulator. There we go. Thank you very much for that nice introduction.
Great. And, thank you very much for being here.
Yeah, it's absolutely a pleasure to be here. I don't know if in Second Life I've stood at a podium in a while. That's great. It's a different feeling. It's always amazing to see how different physical structures in the virtual world feel the same way, right, that they do in the real world and cause us to behave differently. As we've been building High Fidelity, it's been really interesting to, you know, go from, you know, having just a head to having a body to thinking about chairs and kind of, you know, reworking our way through all the different structures that that have been built in Second Life and in virtual worlds. It's a lot of fun. So thank you very much for having me. It's an honor. What I plan to do is talk for a while today. But I want to save a bunch of time at the end for some, questions in text. So I've got my text window open, although I guess try not to type questions until I get to that point, because I probably won't be able to scroll back and find them, although I'm sure I get a few of our people out here to help me. But looks like a big crowd, and I'm glad to see everybody here and a few familiar faces. I think I saw Joe Yardley there chatting in text, and I just saw a great update from her blog on the work we're doing at High Fidelity. So thanks, Joe, for doing that work. Let's see. I guess let's start with Ready Player One. I bet everybody out there has read Ready Player One, haven't they? I mean, I bet a lot of you have. I know when I read Ready Player One, was delighted by it, and I was so excited. I dropped the author an email, and I'm going to try to get together with him next time he's here in San Francisco. Told him, you know, hey, come and see what we're building, and it'd be fun to compare notes on it. I think Ready Player One is, you know, sort of this decade or the last couple years version of Snow Crash. Great. Kind of a roadmap, you know, certainly it's a fictional account, but it's obviously not far from what we can do today with technology. And in particular, Ready Player One talks a lot about education. You know, there's this idea thrown out there that we're, that kids in particular in that story can attend school entirely inside the virtual world with the aid of, you know, something like the Oculus or something like that. And, I was really struck by that, and it made me think about all the amazing things that have happened in education inside Second Life, and looking at Ready Player One and looking at what's happening, what you guys have done today in Second Life, I think should tell us quite a bit about the future, putting those two things together. In fact, I think that there's so many things, there's so many wonderful things that have happened in Second Life, but nowhere is in my mind as compelling an example of the future as what's happened in education. Second Life, I think, though it's early and, you know, there's lots, you know, there's lots of things that we still want to be able to do in virtual worlds that we can't yet do. I think that Second Life has been in so many ways perfect for experiments and then a lot of actual great work to be done in education, and that's been pretty inspiring. And so when I read Ready Player One, it didn't surprise me that the author really focused on this idea of how education could be replaced by virtual reality. I mean, for those who don't know me, let me start this talk with my own kind of history and fascination with virtual worlds and, you know, why I got into them. As a kid, I played with electronics a lot. I programmed computers, but even before that, I was kind of a hands-on tinkerer working with electronics and, you know, my dad's, you know, power tools, anything else to get my hands on. And I love to build things. And I was a creative. I am a creative guy. And I would, you know, I'd always dream up some weird contraption that I wanted to make, whether it was a hovercraft or a go-kart or a pretend gun or whatever. And I'd be trying to build it out of the things I could find around the house. And a story I always tell about virtual worlds was when I was in high school, I cut through the roof of my bedroom because I wanted to make my door go straight up into the ceiling, like in Star Trek. I thought that would be cool. And as I was doing that, even though I was pretty comfortable with working with my hands, you know, it's obviously quite a bit of work to cut through the ceiling of your house and through the ceiling joists and install a garage door opener up in your attic, which is what I did. And, you know, doing work like that is hard, and it's a lot harder to sort of execute on an idea like that in the real world than it is to imagine it. And so as computers really came up to speed, and then as the internet sort of came upon all of us, the thing I wanted to do the most was to build some sort of a space in which we could all build things, you know, realize things that we were dreaming up. And so really at from a first perspective, super, super motivated to build virtual worlds, sort of not because they would be better games, and not at the outset because they would be a really important sort of space between people, but instead because I just wanted to build crazy stuff. I was just intrigued by what you might be able to do with a world like this. So that was kind of the first inspiration. I guess the other thing that really moved me was this idea of complexity and emergence and how virtual worlds could sort of contain the laws of physics inside them. And what that would mean was that if they were big enough and if they had enough scale and if they could have enough stuff and enough people inside them, they would begin to have the amazing, spectacular properties that the real world has, you know, like cities and flocks of birds and all of the things that we are surrounded by in the real world. I felt that they could happen inside virtual worlds, and I wanted to see that happen and make it happen. So, you know, that was really the lifelong passion that I've had for virtual worlds. And it's the very particular, it's that particular passion that continues to give me energy and get me up every day in the morning and keep me working on this stuff. And as I've said many times before, here in Second Life, I'll never stop working on this stuff. I think virtual worlds are hopefully my unique contribution to civilization or to humanity, however I can, and I'm going to keep working on them. And in fact, I'm working on them now, and I'm going to tell you more about that now. So, but, you know, first let's kind of talk about where we are. I mean, Second Life is just absolutely enormous. It has a huge population, a huge economy. You know, there's a million of us or so in here. Along with education, you know, pretty much everything we've seen in Second Life is pretty awe-inspiring and jaw-dropping, and it has continued to delight and entertain and engage and challenge people for since 2003, I guess, when we sort of formally dubbed it complete. So I guess the first question is, you know, as they say, you know, where is my jetpack? Why aren't there a billion people using virtual worlds today? You know, there are a billion people using the internet. Why aren't there billions of people using virtual worlds? Why are there a million of us here doing this and not a billion? So let me talk about that a little bit. I think a lot of the things that have happened over the last couple of years in particular have really made me look back and ponder you know, how we get from a million to a billion. I guess the first thing I'd say is it's not for lack of passion and capability and actual examples. The things that are here in Second Life, are, as we all know, are just absolutely jaw-dropping. Everybody here has had one or more or dozens of moments where you just, you know, you just kind of stood there almost speechless because you were so amazed by the very fact that you were literally in this new world that had these remarkable properties. So, it's not that anything is kind of going wrong with respect to what we're all doing here. It's just incredibly hard to get in. In fact, I think one of the very few things we all here in Second Life have in common, one of the very few things, and I think that's great, you know, such tremendous diversity here of work and people and cultures and everything. But the one thing we all have in common is we've got a ton of, we have a willingness to devote a tremendous amount of time and energy into learning how to get in here, how to interact with things, how to communicate with people. We are willing to devote very significant amounts of our time and energy to doing what we do here. The you know, simplest activities like meeting a new friend and keeping track of them, walking into this place today and sitting down, building something, of course. These are things that are extremely challenging things to do in virtual reality today. And so why is that? You know, when Second Life came out, everybody at the time said, well, the UI is not quite right. You guys are kind of hardware hacker sort of guys, which was totally true. That was what we were. You got to make the UI and the user experience really good. You got to make it work for everybody. And as soon as you guys sort out a couple of issues around how this darned, you know, UI works, why, there's going to be billions of people in here. And the fact is that didn't happen. And it wasn't just us trying. There was about $500 million in venture capital spent on companies that tried to compete with Second Life. And with a very few exceptions, those companies are all gone now. And so why is it that user interface design didn't sort of cross that gap and get us all in here? And let me tell you what I think it is. I think it's the mouse. And that's why we're in such an exciting time today. So fundamentally, if you use Second Life, just about all of us, you've got to use a mouse and a keyboard to do everything here. And I'll tell you my own take on that. Well, first of all, a mouse has 2 degrees of freedom. You can move your finger up and down and side to side. That's what I mean by 2 degrees of freedom. So you can only move in two directions at once. Now, of course, as we all know, you can use your fingers to make a kind of a cord on the keyboard, if you will. And, you can use that cord to tell the computer to do other stuff. So of course, you know, you can sort of translate that side to side motion into an up or down motion or a rotating motion if you're grabbing an object, but you have to use your other fingers on the keyboard to do that. And I believe that a process of kind of using your fingers in that way, kind of playing a chord and moving the mouse, is just incredibly, incredibly difficult. I think it's like learning to play the piano. So we got a lot of piano players in here, myself included. A lot of you guys are much better at it than me. But make no mistake, I think that you've learned a skill that is tremendously challenging and an amazing skill you should be proud of. But that level of difficulty means that you've got to spend 10 or 12 hours, you know, just kind of getting your feet on the ground in here. And that's something that a billion people aren't going to do yet. So the first thing is this problem of 2 degrees of freedom. We've got to be able to have this. I think everything we're doing right now could almost instantly kind of jump into the hands of orders of magnitude more people if we didn't have to use the mouse to do what we're doing. So, there's another problem though, and so I may come back and talk about that mouse problem, but I think the other problem is that it's hard to communicate with each other in here. We're all in here using either the mouse. I'm sorry. We're all in here using either our hands, text on the keyboards, our ability to animate and move our avatars' bodies a little bit, And some of us are using, like I am right now, voice to talk. But human communication in its richest form has a tremendous amount of, you know, multiple modality. It enables us to establish, for example, you know, empathy and synchronization and kind of deep understanding within seconds in many cases. It lets us communicate in very powerful ways. Now, of course, we've learned here, and this is inspiring and amazing, to use the venue of text and a little bit of avatar animation to communicate in ways that the human race had never learned before. And of course, that's one of the things that's so inspiring about Second Life. But it's still a very thin pipe. Pushing our kind of minds when we're face to face with each other through the tiny pipe of text and a little bit of voice and a little bit of body movement is, it's pretty thin. It's pretty hard to push ourselves through that pipe. And again, we all learn to do it here. And I think sometimes I talk about this and people think that I'm saying that we're not communicating richly. No, we are communicating richly here. But again, it's an extraordinary learning challenge. Everybody here, I bet, can tell stories about the nuances of how they learned to communicate with other people effectively in Second Life. And again, it's a very rich learned skill. So this makes us a very elite kind of a private club here of people that know how to do some really amazing things. So how do we get beyond that? Well, first, let me go back to that mouse problem. I mean, the big picture here. And this totally, and again, this totally relates to education because it is education, frankly, that I think has made sort of the most progress setting up the basic structures, the classrooms, the schedules, you know, the forms of meeting like what we're doing right now that, you know, that it's education that is so ready in a virtual world for these couple of basic advances that we now need to make. And as I'm going to say, I believe that those advances are here today. And so we're going to be able to add them to Second Life. We're going to be able to build new virtual worlds like High Fidelity by using these advances. So the first one is hardware. The first incredible advance is that we're not going to need to use the mouse much longer as our primary interface, and we're going to be able to use hardware devices to extend the richness of our ability to both communicate and manipulate the world. So let me talk about that. Now, we all know about the Oculus. Everybody's watched that. It's incredibly exciting to see Facebook buy Oculus and kind of validate our whole space here by doing that. It's just unbelievably cool that that's happened. It's going to bring a lot of eyes to the table. People are going to get curious again, I think, the way they were curious initially about Second Life in 2006 when we saw all the worldwide attention we got. So the Oculus is incredible because it basically does allow us to establish a real degree of visual immersion there. You know, the word used by the folks at Valve and Oculus's presence, with wonderful Michael Abrash talk, I'm sure many of you have seen it, where he really does a great job elucidating the details of what sort of visual presence means, you know, what makes you feel immersed in a world. And the Oculus definitely creates that, and that's going to be just astounding. The Oculus also allows you to use those degrees of freedom of turning your head. You know, you can look around the world, and you can nod your head and shake your head and, you know, move your head when you're talking to somebody else. And that's also just absolutely amazing in terms of what it gives us. But actually, I think the Oculus is almost at the tip of the iceberg. It's a very hard problem, and I think those guys are going to continue to just do the amazing work they've done to continue to solve it. I've tried the, you know, the DK2 prototypes. I'm sure some of you have as well. You are just going to fall down dead when you see the Oculus that's actually going to be released to the public in numbers. I mean, it is just unbelievable. But there's a lot more work to be done. So, for example, motion controllers. If I was holding the Hydra controllers that I use in High Fidelity right now, I would be able to talk to you with my hands. And right now, while I'm talking to you, I am using my hands, and it's a very powerful way to communicate. We all know that. But none of your hands are moving, and neither are mine. And the reason for that is we don't have motion controllers. There are a ton of different ways to detect the movement of our hands and our bodies that are coming out. There's the Hydra controllers that we use with High Fidelity today. There are several amazing new technologies. Sixth Sense, the company, is about to come out with the STEM system, which is just a really amazing system that I was using just the other night and is just You know, just the imagination of connecting a STEM system to Second Life is just too much to imagine. You know, you've got this ability to basically move your whole hands and upper body skeleton, absolutely perfectly reach out and grab things on a table, certainly talk with your hands, grab somebody else. It's just incredible. There's a number of other companies trying different techniques as well. There's a little Kickstarter called Prio VR that is doing a similar thing where they're able to capture your skeletal, you know, kind of upper body, actually full body motions. So there's a whole bunch of hardware technology going on in that regime. And we're soon going to be able to have many, many more degrees of freedom. Now, a double hand controller like a Hydra basically gives me 12 degrees of freedom, 3 degrees of rotation and 3 degrees of translation or movement back and forth on each of my hands. That's an extraordinary, that's 12 degrees of freedom compared to 2 for the mouse. And that's not counting my head. So how do we follow the head? Now, you can use the Oculus to follow your head around, but in an education setting, you may not always want to put an Oculus on. For example, you might be sharing a room with other people and want to talk to them while you're using the virtual world, like many of us do with Second Life today. In that case, we're going to use cameras. So software is so fast. There's been so much good work done lately. And in addition to this, we now have the option in some cases of using 3D depth cameras that then make the process of sort of finding a person inside the camera much, much easier. We've got the Kinect, you know, for the full body version, and then we've got the short range cameras like the PrimeSense camera that we're using with high fidelity. These 3D cameras allow us to do two important things. They allow us to capture the movement of the head, and they also, even more importantly, and if I understand you guys just actually saw the video from SVVR, which you got to see. If you saw that video, you got to see me talking as an avatar with my face moving. So the other thing these 3D cameras can do is capture the face. And the experience of listening to a person's voice while you're watching their lips move and you're watching their eyebrows move up and down. And when you talk, they nod back at you because they're listening to you and paying attention and looking into your eyes. That experience is absolutely riveting. Absolutely riveting. And pulling that particular experience, by the way, back to education. I heard somebody write something very elegant the other day. They were talking about how online courses have not had as high a success rate as one might expect. That is, there's all this amazing online coursework you can do now, but in many cases, people aren't completing those courses at the rate that they're completing college. Now, of course, some of this is simply that we've got a broader, wonderfully, that we've got a broader pathway now, so we've got many more people, you know, going to school than ever before. And so, of course, less people are going to complete school. But what the writer was saying was that there's something about being face-to-face. There's something about being in a classroom and having a teacher, a living teacher, not a book. There's something about that that makes education work. And I think the person said something like, education is messy. Like, we don't actually understand it. And I think that maps very well onto the kind of work that we're doing at High Fidelity and the magic of Second Life in general, which is that there's something about being next to people or feeling like you're really there with someone that somehow is magical and is important in so many human interactions. And nowhere is there a better example than education. We've got to be there with other people. And so keep that in mind, you know, as we think about this. So if we can put ourselves really face to face with a teacher, for example, or in a small group learning something new, we're going to see all the great groundwork that's been done here just explode as that sort of magic person to person channel is opened up by the virtual environment. So beyond this hardware, beyond this idea of the Oculus, these motion controllers that are coming out, you know, imminently, these 3D cameras I'm touching on, all this inexpensive hardware we're going to get access to here, what else do we need? What else is going to take us across the gap there and bring this thing to a billion people? Well, first let me talk about latency. You've heard people talk about latency with the Oculus. You know, they say, well, if you turn your head and you want to see the virtual world show up in the direction that you're now looking. You've probably heard these numbers that say, you know, you've got 10 milliseconds or so to put that graphic up in front of your eyes. Otherwise, your brain won't believe that it's really happening. So that 10 milliseconds is the latency between your head moving and the image showing up. But at High Fidelity and also at Second Life, you know, to start, but it's been a huge focus at High Fidelity, we've been exploring a different kind of latency. And the latency that we're exploring is one-on-one presence. That is to say, if I take the link between you and I, when we're standing next to each other in a virtual world, and I impose latency on that link, I start slowing down or delaying the flow of information between two individuals. Where does the magic stop working? So to start at actually one of the most difficult cases that, by the way, I don't think we can easily solve soon in virtual worlds. What about two musicians playing music together, where the musicians are really good? They're jazz musicians, for example. We've done this experiment at High Fidelity. In other words, if I'm playing drums and you're playing a guitar, and we're both avatars, how short does the time delay need to be between us? Well, one answer to this question can be given by the question, how far apart can two real musicians sit from each other and still play together? And the answer is not very far. And the speed of sound in the air is 1 millisecond per foot. So if musicians, to really jam together, need to sit within, say, 20 feet of each other, that means you need to be about 20 milliseconds apart for it to work. Now, it turns out we've tested this by actually separating musicians and then putting headsets on them so that they can hear each other, but then imposing, very, very carefully imposing with some professional audio equipment, an exact number of milliseconds between the performers. And what we've seen when we've done those experiments is that, yeah, the number is about 15 milliseconds. Some people say 10, some people say 20, but whatever. It's in that range. Now, 15 milliseconds is a very short time period. And in fact, even with the amazing stuff we're doing with High Fidelity, it's probably a little too short for me to basically, realistically yet, allow two performers that are in different cities to play together as professional musicians in a virtual environment, unless they kind of learn to follow each other in this kind of non-real sort of way. And of course, that's another learned skill, and that may be an amazing experience, but it's something that I think is going to keep, you know, most professional musicians from being able to play together in a virtual world. Now, of course, they can play together on a stage together and then play into the virtual world, and I think that's one of the things that High Fidelity is going to just, you know, is going to just be crazy cool. I think that all these hardware devices and all this synchronization I'm talking about is just going to make that experience really pretty amazing. So, latency is this really important thing. Now how much latency can there be between you and me when we're just talking face to face to feel good? And the answer is, a lot of studies have been done on that, and the answer is a really good answer in this case. It's about 100 milliseconds, about 1/10 of a second. So the ITU, International Telecommunication Union, did a formal study on voice over IP when there was a lot of sort of IP telephony going on. And they did this study where they imposed latency between people, just like we've been doing. And they found that the number was about 150 milliseconds. At about 150 milliseconds, everybody started saying, this is a bad experience. We're interrupting each other. This doesn't feel good. And below about 150 milliseconds, they said, I can't tell. It's no different than just, you know, talking face to face with somebody. So that's interesting. Now, that was on a voice connection only, but we've repeated these analyses and tests with different types of connections and imposing latencies on different things. And we found that the number of 100 milliseconds is probably about right for establishing one-on-one sort of emotional connection between two people that are talking to each other. So here's the thing. With all this new hardware, and by writing the networking layer and the pieces of software really well, you can get the delay down to 100 milliseconds. That is, everybody in the United States can talk face to face in a place like High Fidelity and watch their faces move and their lips move with a less than 100 millisecond delay. By the way, your cell phone today is about 500 milliseconds, way over the ITU's number. And that's why we all hate using our cell phones. Skype is about 250 plus milliseconds if you've got video on. And voice over IP, such as you use typically in virtual worlds, is usually at about 800 milliseconds or worse. So it's really slow. But if you get things down to 100 milliseconds and you can watch somebody's face and listen to them talk at the same time, and maybe if you can even lean your head a little closer or turn your head to hear them a little better out of one ear, it's an astonishing experience. And one that when you see it, you're going to really be amazed. And that's a big part of what we're working on here at High Fidelity. So in addition to all these hardware devices, we need to have fast networks, low latency, and new, well-written, specifically written software to enable that data to get back and forth between people at a really high speed, just like what's being done in custom hardware with the Oculus. But the good news is 100 milliseconds, by the way, is halfway around the world. 100 milliseconds is the ping time, one-way ping time, half the ping time, from here to Singapore. I've tried it. We did a keynote presentation in Hong Kong at the SIGGRAPH conference just a little while ago. And we were able to have a live conversation with somebody in San Francisco, looking at their face and interrupting each other and talking to each other in a very, very natural, amazing way, with me as one of the talkers on stage in Hong Kong. So the world is only 100 milliseconds around by light, halfway around. And so that means that if 100 milliseconds works for basic human experience, if we can really be fundamentally in contact with each other emotionally, face-to-face, it means it's going to work for just about everybody on Earth. So I'm glad the Earth is actually as small as it is. if we'd ended up with a larger Earth, I wouldn't be able to tell you this good news. So what's the architecture of this space? Let me talk now a little bit about what is the architecture of the virtual, what do I think is the architecture of virtual worlds moving forward, and also of the virtual worlds that as educators you're probably going to be in and ultimately going to need. And I think there's obviously some of this for you guys, you know, forgive me if this seems obvious. You are the great thinkers that have been here, you know, the longer than anybody. So you'll probably find this fairly obvious. But let me summarize what I think, you know, beyond the hardware and the latency and the speed and the sound and everything, let me summarize what I think the architecture needs to be, or make a couple of points about it. I made a blog post the other day about identity. I think people were talking a lot about identity in the wake of the Facebook acquisition. Facebook are very, very smart guys, and I think that I'm sure that they're thinking these same things, Facebook notwithstanding. But I think identity is something that does continue to evolve to be more like the web in virtual worlds. I think identity disclosure, that is, my name is Philip Rosedale. I am really Philip Rosedale. Hi, you know, my name's Philip. It's nice to meet you. I think that those things are not things that really should be tied to avatars. They're things that should be choices made by individuals who are using their avatars. So I've come to believe even that the sort of putting your name over your head like we all have here, and certainly putting a unique name over your head that is basically a handle that can be used to find you anywhere in the virtual world. We don't do that on the web. We certainly don't do it in real life. And I don't think long term we're going to do it in virtual worlds either. I think we have to basically walk up to each other and shake hands. And, you know, if you remember what I look like, well, the next time you see me, you'll know who I am. I don't think that having a fixed identity system in which we can sort of follow each other around everywhere and, you know, always get to somebody by a sort of a hashtag is likely to be the default case, at least for shared virtual worlds. So I think the virtual worlds of the future will have choices of identity. I think we're also going to need mechanisms, especially as educators. We're going to need mechanisms to basically say, hey, it's Philip Rosedale. It's really me. I'm here for my class. You know, here's my driver's license. Of course, there's a lot of easy ways to do that, but I think we're going to need to build them. And so I'm not saying that we should be anonymous. I'm saying that when we want to declare who we are, we actually will probably, not only will we do it, but we'll have really great ways. We'll need to have great ways of identifying ourselves, you know, to our coworkers or to an educator. I think it's pretty straightforward to build that, and it's one of the things we're doing at High Fidelity, but I think it's an important issue. Obviously, and we've all been through lots of iterations and experiments in this, we, regardless whether you're doing education or design or play or art, we need some kind of a shared marketplace or exchange, which is probably independent of all the different servers in which you can exchange content, in which you can pay for things, in which you can move stuff around. You know, you obviously, I mean, again, this is patently obvious to everybody here, but, you know, if the future of virtual worlds, as I think it is an internetwork, that is, it's a world of worlds, it's many, many, many connected virtual worlds, enormously larger even than something like Second Life, how are we going to walk around in the same clothes between those worlds? So we're going to need some sort of an exchange, a marketplace, place to buy things, place to move things around that allows us to move around. And of course, there's been lots of work done on that and things like OpenSim today and marketplaces that connect content there. But again, that stuff's not done and it's not, not mainstream yet. And I think that's going to have to happen as well. As I've said many times in the past, I believe that for virtual worlds to really go the distance and become a fundamental tool that we all, as you know, citizens of the planet, are using every day, they've got to be quite a bit more like the internet than they are today. In particular, I think we've basically all got to run our own servers. I mean, the phenomena and the linking system and the software and everything has to be very akin to the web. That is, we've got to all be able to set up and run our own servers. But like the web, those servers need to be visually and spatially connected to each other. So I got to walk through a door if I want out of my room into yours, or I need to be able to, you know, park my my educational facility next to yours because there's a benefit to that. And we need to be able to sync up and figure out a way to tell everybody else that our two spaces are sitting next to each other. And if you look left from mine, you see yours. And if you look right from yours, you see mine. So that kind of spatial interconnectedness between virtual worlds is, again, very akin to the hyperlink that has made the web so powerful. And I think it's what we're going to need to what we're going to need to build for virtual worlds. And of course, again, there's been lots of good initial work done on this. At High Fidelity, we're just trying to say, well, what comes next? And, you know, what are the basic tools that people need? You know, like if you need a way to be able to find each other, if you need a way to be able to find a location like San Francisco or Harvard University or something, well, you're probably going to have a lookup system that lets you type in Harvard University somewhere. And that's probably a lot like DNS, you know, and this is something that we're thinking about as well. But at the end of the day, I think that the virtual world of the future, as it takes its next big leap, probably propelled by all this exciting hardware, is going to be an internetwork of virtual worlds, and we're going to need to make all that work. And again, things like OpenSim have started the work, and of course Second Life, you know, have started the work to kind of get us all thinking about those issues. You know, the code, the software probably needs to be open source. The protocols need to be inspectable, just like the web. Most of the stuff on the web that we trust today, things like SSL and DNS, are things that are either open source or open protocols. You can't do a really great human endeavor on the internet like that without having a pretty fair degree of open documentation and visibility into that stuff. You know, as an engineer, I'm just a fundamental believer in that. I think that's almost best practice nowadays, so I probably don't even need to say it, but I think it goes without saying. I think it needs to be, obviously, if it's an internet work, it's a lot of small servers loosely joined, as they say. You know, there's no off switch for the virtual world. You know, there's no central agency that allows you to turn it on and off. I think the Ready Player One idea of kind of, you know, one great company that controlled it all is a delightful dystopian you know, fantasy, and it makes the fiction great. But I don't think it's likely that the virtual worlds of the future are that way. And you know, I think the Internet of websites today demonstrates that that's pretty much true. I mean, of course, we've all got our concerns about this or that big company, but the reality is that there are more companies today than ever before, and you know, more participants in the dialogue about how things should work and how stuff should be controlled. So let's talk for a second about scale as a final thing. Now, I know that there are thousands and thousands and thousands of educators in Second Life. And moreover, I'm going to boldly assert that a great event like this would attract a good percentage of them. And yet, despite the fact that I think we're on the corner, we're on a beautiful four-corner connect here of several sims, we're only able to interact together as audience and speaker with a few hundred people here. So that's great. That's better than anything that's been done in the past, and I'm super proud of it. But this stadium I'm standing in right now has a capacity for several thousand people to listen to me, and you know, with the right audio, which of course is easy online, we can make it so that we can engage in a real conversation with those people. We can have a real forum, but we can't get thousands of people together in one place in a virtual world right now. We can't make that work yet. So scale. We got to design for scale. What does that mean? Well, it means several different things, and all things we're working on at High Fidelity, and all things that, again, you know, lots of folks here have worked on. But I guess what I would say is these scaling problems are soluble. But let me go on about that, because I think it points to another really interesting dynamic architecture about the future of virtual worlds and how we all have to help participate in creating them. And that is that a typical server machine today, if you're holding a class and you want to have a bunch of people come to that class, when you step up the bandwidths to several megabits per person, as we're doing at High Fidelity, and you need to do that to carry all this data, very high quality audio, facial animation, all this stuff, right? It means that the amount of data that has to be sent out to each individual is, you know, megabits of data at a time. Now, for those who are more technical here, you all know what that means, which is it means that like one internet server, you know, one fast desktop machine, one computer inside an Amazon complex or whatever, it can only service like 10 to 100 people. And that's part of the challenge of Second Life. Now, Second Life has about 40,000 servers, which is just incredible. But each of those servers can only serve, you know, dozens of people at a time. And as we need to move more data over these networks, the number in some cases for a while will actually go down. So if we wanted to have a get together for several thousand people, we need, for the time of that get together, to have, you know, dozens of machines or 100, you know, 100 or so or something machines available to us. If we want to have a rock concert for 100,000 people, which I very much believe we can do in the next couple of years, we actually are going to need thousands of machines. A really big event might require more machines than comprise the entire network of Second Life today. So how are we going to do this? The good news is we can do it. We built an architecture for it at High Fidelity. I'm sure other people will do their own experiments. I'm sure improvements to Second Life will also, you know, start to go in that direction. The good news is that there is a way to do it. It's just, it's kind of hard. Basically, as soon as people start showing up in this space, you got to start pulling up additional machines and kind of connecting those machines together in real time. But there are architectures that have done this before, like Skype or BitTorrent. You can allocate machines pretty quickly in Amazon, probably not quickly enough to, you know, come together in a few minutes for an event, but you can get a lot of machines online pretty quickly. There's a question of who's paying for those machines, but there are ways of doing this. So technically, it's feasible to put 1,000 machines together. And for that matter, 1,000 machines serving a rock concert really aren't even all that expensive if you're only using them for a couple hours. So how do we do that? Well, the basic problem you run into if you imagine a virtual world that has a billion people in it is that there actually aren't enough servers out there to host them all. If everybody on the internet was simultaneously being delivered several megabits of data in real time and talking to each other, actually, there's probably not even enough servers out there. Now, Google has a lot of servers doing things like search, but if you start counting at places like Amazon and Rackspace, the number you get to is that the number of servers out there is probably somewhere around 500,000 to 1,000,000 physical servers. By the way, it should make us all the more impressed with Second Life that we're actually using a significant percentage of those machines to run Second Life, which is pretty cool. But all in all, we've only got hundreds of thousands of machines available. So, you know, in the words of when we started High Fidelity and we got into this, I'd say in the words of was it Richard Dreyfuss in that? Not Richard Dreyfuss, Roy Schneider in Jaws. You know, we're going to need a bigger boat. So, what's the bigger boat look like? So, I believe, and this is what we're working on at High Fidelity, I believe that the bigger boat is the idea that we can get access to everybody's machines and use them as servers. Many of you have heard of projects like SETI, where you can dedicate your computer to searching for, you know, looking at the radio signals coming from those big dishes and looking for, you know, people out there in space. You can also dedicate your machine to do things like protein folding. Think about something like SETI, and then think, could we write a piece of software that not only lets you run your own internet server, your own virtual world server, but also lets you share your machine with your friends or with a larger community, imagine a system that uses an economy like the Second Life economy to do that and allows us to basically sort of borrow machines from each other whenever we need them. We've done lots of work on this. We actually have it working. It's not ready for prime time yet, so you're not trying it yet. But I don't have anything for you to download right now, but we believe that this is a completely solvable problem and that the next generation of virtual worlds can actually be built as a kind of a cloud of machines that are shared by and borrowed from all of us. So that's something that we're working on. That would allow us to do that kind of a rock concert. And it would allow you as educators to very efficiently at a low cost pull those machines together. Why, most of our machines that we've got when we're not using something like Second Life, when we're at work or something, we've got these big powerful desktop machines that are connected over, you know, typically cable modem connections at, you know, 50 megabits down and 10 megabits up. Those are very powerful machines. If we could borrow those from you, if you could borrow those from each other, you would. And that would potentially give us access to a lot more machines than we've ever had access to. That's right. I saw somebody say FidoNet. Absolutely. I mean, we've been thinking about ways to share machines for a long time. And I think we're going to do it to create the next generation of virtual worlds. So I think that's a pretty amazing thought. I mean, I think that it's doable. I think that it's what we're working on. And I think that the implication of being able to get access to a number of machines for the simulation and the streaming of the virtual world that is literally several orders of magnitude larger than even what we have in the entire physical planet on Earth, it's pretty amazing to imagine what that might be like. The other thing, you know, as a side note about this, that just on the technology side, probably more related to just the oh wow experience, like the Oculus of virtual reality, than the specific needs, say, of educators, is that we got to be able to sort of see more stuff in the world. And so that is to say, when you fly up in the air in Second Life, why can't we see the whole thing, right? For those of you who have seen those pictures that we used to do once in a while of what it all looks like, if you kind of render it all, you know, write a routine that offline basically renders everything on all the islands out into the distance, it's just a completely, you know, heart-stopping thing to see how much we've all built together, you know, and how big this space is. It's, you know, we're the size of Los Angeles, I believe, at this point, you know, roughly the size of the LA basin here, and that's just a staggering amount of stuff. So we need a technology that lets us even better than Second Life. We need technology that lets us fly up in the air and look out, you know, 10 miles into the distance and see things. And we believe there's a way to do that as well. And it's actually tied to the same problem of, you know, needing to have 1,000 people show up at a concert. We think the same technology that kind of lets people show up at a concert will also let us, you know, put an enormous number of prims, if you will, right on top of me, and then back away from those and not have to download them all and render them all as we often do today. So I think there's a lot of neat technology there. So, you know, in summary, and then we'll have some questions, this hardware that we're about to see come onto the market, kind of led by the wonderful, you know, poster child of the Oculus, is going to fundamentally open the doors to an easier way to sort of interface with the virtual environment. And that means people are going to flood in here because they're not going to have this learning curve, this incredible learning curve that we've all taken on and mastered. I think that the architecture needs to be very open. And I think that we need to contrive a way to use orders of magnitude more servers than we've been able to use thus far to simulate virtual worlds. And I think that with those things put together, I think the future for educators will be just incredible, because I think you'll suddenly have the ability to bring a lot of people together in one space, and you'll have the ability as a teacher to teach by looking into the eyes of your students and using all this other wonderful capability that we've got here by not having to be embodied physically in a space. You know, you're going to be able to use that in a context and a setting where it's all real, where the people are really looking at you and they're really paying attention, and you really can, you know, throw an eraser at somebody, I guess, if they're not listening to you. So, thank you very much for having me. And I hope that's a good, look at things. And why don't we shift now, to a few questions. And again, I just thank you very much for letting me give this talk today.
Great. Thank you very much, Philip. If people want to put their questions into local chat, what we'll do is we'll read them out and Philip will provide some answers.
Absolutely. Thanks for all that chat. I saw everybody stop talking. Just scroll back. I saw, when did we expect, if you guys can stop chat clapping, that's good. I can read. Here we go. Cool. Nymph Hathaway asks, when can we expect High Fidelity to open? I don't know. We've been working on it for about a year. We've got some things working. There is an alpha sign up form on our site. I'd encourage you all to certainly do that. You're more than welcome to. There's a sign up form at highfidelity.io where you can sign up for our alpha. We've already got a number of people on there, and we're starting to let in a very small number of people, but understand that what we've got with High Fidelity isn't working yet, not in the way, for example, that Second Life was at the moment that it launched. We still got some more work to be done, but we are starting to let people, for example, explore the experience of looking at each other face-to-face and talking and coming to a meetup and hanging out with me and, you know, kind of feeling how different it is to be in there with this very low latency and hardware controllers. So hopefully that's helpful. Nick asks, hang on a minute here. What
do I got here? Do you see controllers like Leap or Kinect in this wave of the future virtual world?
Why don't you guys do that? That's awesome. Read those out to me. Thank you very much, Phil. Okay. The Leap and the Kinect, yes, as I said, I think the Kinect is a very powerful tool. It's what we use. We use the short range version, which is called the Carmine, the PrimeSense Carmine. It's basically the same thing as a Kinect. We've actually 3D printed little clips that put it on the laptop. If you saw that video of me, you saw me. I had one clipped on my laptop. We use those today to capture your face animations. Whether we can use depth cameras to capture the hands well enough is still, the jury's still out on that. The Leap controller is a very cool idea, but it also has some big problems with extraneous light, and it has a small work envelope. So you have to put your hands up over your keyboard, and I think that's a difficult way to manipulate things. But again, there's so much great hardware coming out. Lots of problems are going to get solved by different startups. I mentioned the ones that I like the best, but we're definitely going to see a lot there. Cool.
Okay.
Next.
Cool. Philippe is asking, back in 2008, I asked you if you thought technical issues or social culture issues were the biggest barrier to broad adoption of the metaverse. Have your thoughts changed since then? And if so, how?
Fundamentally, I think it's technical issues. I think we were early. Maybe Philippe, you can remind me as to what I said at the time. But I'm respectful of the huge amount of work we've all done in crossing the cultural challenges that come with having, you know, a worldwide audience of people in the world together. But of course, come on, by and large, that has been just an inspiring, wonderful experience. And I think that there's many, many good technologies and strategies out there for continuing to advance the sort of managing the cultural aspects of the system. I believe it's technical. I believe that we, as I said, must get beyond the mouse and keyboard. If we can do that, as we begin to do that, we're going to see, very, very significant increases in the number of people using virtual world.
Raymond asks, do you believe increases in computing power as individual servers increase in power, that this will help alleviate the server problems over time?
Well, I think we tend to make the system, we tend to also demand more fidelity, to reference my own company name now, with each advance in technology. So we tend to kind of increase the bandwidth we want from the system at pace with the power of the computers. But as I said, I think the more wonderful, well, first of all, we can do things with computers today, given their speed. We're finding that out with High Fidelity that you just can't believe. Like, we can do things with spatialized 3D audio that when you see it, you're just going to go, oh my gosh. I mean, voice in Second Life today is super cool. It's got a bunch of spatialization. Wait until you see what you can do with power machines today. So I think the big challenge is actually just getting a lot of machines into the mix. And that means two things I said. One is an open system in which we can all run our own servers, and two is the system in which we can actually share servers with each other.
Okay. Actually, I've got a follow-on question that, if you don't mind. How do you see the privacy issues relating to that? I mean, as we look at, you know, people wanting to share information, obviously having access to individual computers, how do you see that being impacted by, you know?
Yeah, I mean, the privacy issues around this are obviously going to be rich. I think that when you talk about people deploying their own virtual world servers, I think that, and I mentioned this in my blog post about identity, I think that we are going to make decisions of trust as avatars coming into a server about how much we want to tell that server about us. And I think the only architectures that are going to work are going to be architectures in which there's a negotiation. So what I mean by that is I'm going to log into your server, but I don't even know you at all. And it's going to say, hey, I need to know your true name, you know, before I let you into the server. And I'm going to say, no, you know, I won't give you that. I won't come in here if you're asking for that. I think there'll be a gradated scale of interactions that are between server operators and their visitors, basically, that are coming in. And I think that they'll negotiate a level of trust in the same way that we do with a website. It won't be an all or nothing affair where you've got, you know, one big world, and then, you know, the big world is saying, okay, you know, here's what you got to tell me about yourself to get in, and then I'm going to tell everybody else that information about you, you know, which is kind of the de facto how we do virtual worlds and games today. I think it'll be a negotiation, and I think anonymity will always be the starting point, and then you'll have this appropriate, you'll have this wonderful negotiation that'll happen where, you know, the person who runs the land you're standing on will say, hey, you know, I need to know this about you, and you'll say, well, you know, I'll tell you this, but not that. So I think it's going to work.
Okay. With Carmzy, Melody is asking, will these amazing devices require users such as students, educational institutions, and others to invest in new, expensive, or upgraded hardware? Cost is an issue for many.
That's a good question. I mean, I think with Second Life and education, we saw that ultimately educators were able to find... I think that technology is becoming cheaper and more accessible, and educators are having access to more and more powerful technology. So I can see that gap closing. I do see what you mean. I mean, I think that, certainly with high fidelity, for example, we're focusing on things like WebGL rendering, you know, to be able to provide, you know, basic, you know, things like portals into the virtual world, you know, through not just, you know, on a low-end machine, but actually just through HTML5, you know, if you're talking about WebGL. So I think that the general capability of computing devices in the network means that we'll probably have a more open sense of access across the board. Now, looking into people's eyes, though, and listening to them talk, you know, that does require new hardware. It doesn't necessarily require it for everybody. For example, your educator, you know, your speaker can be empowered to watched. You could be watching your educator's face and eyes move, and you don't have to have your face and eyes move. So I think there are ways to negotiate through this. But I would say that, you know, as with Second Life itself, all of this stuff is driven by advances in technology, and that's going to be true here as well. We're going to have pretty fast machines moving, you know, megabits per second of data around.
I've got a question here from Draxer, who wants to know, will high fidelity make Second Life obsolete?
Well, I think that high fidelity, and as you may know, Linden Lab and Second Life are actually one of the investors in high fidelity. Mm-hmm. High fidelity is a pretty aggressive set of new ideas, as I've just explained. And so I feel like what we're doing at High Fidelity is sort of farther out and more aggressive and so experimental and different that a lot of the research ideas that will come out of it will be things that you'll see getting into Second Life over time. I mean, there's a Second Life version, as I understand, for the Oculus now. I haven't tried it yet, but I'm sure it's an absolute delight to use. And I think we're going to see other things like that. You know, maybe you'll see some of the innovations we've built in High Fidelity around things like facial animation, you know, being things that you can try in Second Life. I think that's going to work. I think broadly the team at Second Life, and certainly this is my perspective, understand that to do really, really crazy new things that are farther out, like what we're doing with High Fidelity, you really want to do that as a new company with a small team. And so that's what we're trying to do. But I have very open communications. I was just with Ebbe, who's a wonderful guy, who's the new CEO at Linden, I believe, if I understand. He's speaking at this conference as well. I've got a great relationship with him. I was just over there the other day telling him about what we're doing, you know, sharing notes about, thoughts about Second Life. So, definitely open channels there. And I think that we can all help each other. And I think the opportunity long term is big enough that even if we are, you know, two different companies that are competing in some way, you know, who cares if the overall market opportunity is growing by, you know, a function of, you know, 10 every year as this technology starts to hit. Oh, somebody just said Ebbe's here. Cool. I don't see Ebbe. Hello, Ebbe, wherever you are. He's out there somewhere. I'm having trouble reading all these name tags. See, we can't. Too many name tags.
There's only 200 of them here, so, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And now I'm scanning the audience like a... if I could put my hand up. I'd be putting it up over my eyes right now so I could shield them from the sun as I looked around. Anyhow.
There we go. Alaska's asking, the person, not the state, is asking, how is the learning curve going to be for new users to high fidelity?
Well, as I said, I hope the fundamental thing is that, hey there, he just said hi. I think the fundamental thing is that these higher degree of freedom devices is going to drop the learning curve a lot. I do think there's still going to be a learning curve, though. I mean, again, you know, Second Life, many other companies, everybody's done a lot of great work on this stuff, and some of it's still kind of hard. I mean, there's a lot of aspects of, you know, your inventory, for example, that are just, they're tough. I mean, building a beautiful house in the real world isn't an easy thing either. I mean, I think there's some stuff that's irreducible. You can't expect that the richness of experience that you get from Second Life is something that ultimately can be reduced to sort of taking a pill or you know, just snapping your fingers and learning it immediately. I think there'll still be a learning curve. But like I said at the beginning, and let me underscore that, I believe that the new hardware we've got coming out will make the learning curve profoundly different for people to get to a level of basic, I can do this, and hey, this is kind of fun to do, in a way that is very different than doing it with a mouse and keyboard.
Do you think building better ways of handling identity in virtual worlds could overcome, and I apologize because I did skip through a portion of the question above here, but what they're essentially asking is, you know, this whole idea of real life, virtual versus real life identities, would this be an uphill battle on a purely cultural level in order to gain acceptance of this idea of, you know, opt-in identities?
Well, in a word, no. I mean, we travel to amazing faraway places as humans all the time, and we don't have names. I mean, you know what I mean? The identity problems get solved. I don't see why it would be any different here. I don't see a reason why the technical nature of a virtual world makes the cultural conflict of different strategies around identity unsolvable any more than it would be unsolvable for, you know, people from Asia or North America to travel to Europe. So we see that happening. I think we'll see the same thing happening here. Let's just take like one more. I don't want to. I know we got to. We got to keep this conference going.
we have time, so we're good. But if we've got one more, then I've got one here because I think this one is actually fairly important. And this is coming from Celine Highwater. Will there be an emphasis on making high fidelity accessible to those with disabilities, such as people who are blind or have other, you know, physical limitations?
I mean, I think that that's one of the things that's made Second Life so powerful and compelling and impactful is the degree to which it's been accessible, both at a fundamental level, because Second Life fundamentally is an ability to do things in a world that you don't necessarily have the ability to do in real life, or heck, for that matter, that all of us don't have the ability to do, like flying, for example. So I think Second Life, by its very nature, is accessible. Now, of course, there are lots of pieces, there are lots of specific features that make it more accommodating for people with different disabilities. Second Life, I think, just had a fantastic track record on that. It's been a concern and such an important part of the population for a long time, and always will be. I think that speaking for High Fidelity, which I can speak for, part of our strategy with High Fidelity is to build a lot of the systems in an open source fashion. and in a pluggable fashion. And my suspicion is that the way we're going to do that from the outset will enable us to get lots more people helping us with things like some of the sophisticated feature level things you can do to provide better accessibility. So I bet that we'll be able to do that really well. And I would say that, yes, absolutely, the people that make use of those accessibility features will very much be incredibly impactful in high fidelity, just as they have been here. So, but I think the fact that we're doing it in this open fashion, where we're going to be able to engage lots of people in its development, which by the way, you know, has many similarities to the Second Life Viewer being open source, I think we should also in high fidelity be able to get lots of people helping us and moving quite quickly on that. We're actually doing a little bit of that today. We've actually already got people helping us. Chipping in with pull requests on GitHub and doing things in what we call the work list, which is our kind of contract work website that we built just for more rapidly evolving high fidelity.
Okay, if you have time for just one more question, I think I'll throw this in if we could, and I'll leave this as the last one, I promise.
Let's do one more.
Just because I like the question, and I'm glad somebody asked it. How can we encourage enthusiasm in virtual education?
Gosh, encourage enthusiasm. I don't know. I mean, I think that, don't you have it? I mean, the very fact that we can use this amazing venue and medium to teach, I mean, I don't know, that's just incredibly motivating to me. I think that once we can see each other's faces moving and once we can sort of be in contact with each other in the way that these new pieces of hardware will enable, we're going to greatly amplify the impact and the immediacy and the appeal of the virtual education experience. I mean, I think it's just going to amplify what's already working really well. So I don't know. Absolutely tell me what I can do. But I from my perspective, I guess what I can do as an evangelist for all this and continue to do, and it's why I'm here today and delighted you guys brought me here, is just be a tireless evangelist for how many amazing things around education you can do in the virtual world. So I'm going to keep doing that.
Excellent. Well, Philip, I'd like to thank you very much for coming out. I mean, this was a wonderful surprise when we asked and you said yes. I know everybody here has been just dying to hear you speak. I mean, it's always wonderful when people get a chance to talk to the creator of Second Life. And again, I'd like to thank you very much for being at the conference.
Thanks again very much for having me. Thanks everybody for having me. I'm humbled to have so many people doing so much good work in something that I got to help build. Thank you very much for having me, and talk to you all soon. And I look forward to a successful conference. Take care, everybody. All right, you guys.
It's an animal thing.
So, folks, I do need to apologize with regards to the website. Apparently, in everybody's enthusiasm, you broke it. So, we're busy working with DreamHost right at the moment to get it back up and running. It's slowly starting to behave itself, but it should be another hour or so before it's fully back up. I am trying to get a schedule onto a note card, and as soon as I have that available, we will start getting that around to people. Lori Vaughn, I believe, just let me go back here because I believe she just posted in local chat. We have a social networking opportunity over in the Quadrividium, which is just the two sims to the south of us here. Actually, they're called VWBBE South, of all things. Join us there for an informal discussion on what's hot, what's not, what works, and what irks you about tools, social platforms, and information resources and virtual environments. So this will be an opportunity to share your insights with other colleagues, to pick up pointers on a vast array of knowledge available from those here available at the conference. The other thing to keep in mind is that a lot of the information from the social networking opportunities is going to be published as part of the journal proceedings immediately following the conference. So if you've got good ideas about tools or different social platforms that you're using or that you're interested in, we're going to make all of that information available as soon as the conference is over and make sure that, people will be able to get a copy and be able to share that with other colleagues. So, you know, if you've got some great ideas about tools and social networking, this is a good opportunity in order to share your ideas and share your thoughts about different tools and opportunities that are out there and that's available. Oops, sorry. And then we come back here for 3 o'clock for featured machinima. And Mal Burns will be talking to some of the directors of people who have submitted machinima presentations for this year. Then at 4 o'clock, we have a couple of sim demonstrations, and those will be departing from the south area. One of the things that's not on the conference, well, obviously the website's not up right just yet, but one of the things that's also not on the calendar that we just got confirmation on yesterday is Salandra Zahn is going to be doing a social event at 7 p.m. tonight, and she's going to be doing some performance artwork set to music and a light show. So if you have the opportunity, if you're going to be around for the day and you're going to be around for that, that also will be in the Quadrividium, just inside VWBPE South 1, just to the south of us here. So hopefully everybody enjoyed Philip's presentation. I'm looking forward to all the presentations that are happening over the next couple of days. We have an absolutely incredible program for everybody, and you know, hopefully you will enjoy the conference. And like I said, hopefully we'll have the website back up and running in a couple of minutes as well. So please bear with us. We're doing our best, and we're trying to get those things sorted out.